We have no possibility of uttering any sentence or word out. After uttering out, it has two aspects, sound and meaning. Now, before the third stage, there is another stage. Before I have the thought, this is a watch, there is another and a fourth stage of utterance. That is, I should feel that I should express. The thought should come to my mind. Before the thought came to my mind, where was it? After it came to my mind, it became a thought sentence. And then it became a thought language sentence. And then it came out as the vocal language sentence uttered out. So, before the thought came to my mind, where was the thought? When you meet your friend, you say bujo, sava. Before the two words came to your mind, where were they? Here is a fourth kingdom, which is a mysterious kingdom, into which we are expected to make a journey. Those who make a journey into the fourth kingdom, they know what the word is. Otherwise, we receive thoughts and we think that they are our thoughts. But before we receive thoughts, they are not with us and they are not our thoughts. So, unless we know the fourth state, we cannot have a proper understanding of the sentences we utter. Where was the thought before it came to my mind? Daily think of it for a few minutes. Gradually you will travel towards it and you will be able to understand it. But before you understand it, you will merge in it. You will become itself, and therefore you cannot understand it. For example, before going to bed, a few minutes before sleep, try to question yourself how sleep comes to you. Be ready, let me understand how sleep comes to me. Something happens, and the next morning you will wake up, and you say to yourself, I slept. Otherwise, I would have understood how sleep came to me. Today, let me understand it. If you do this experiment lifelong, you will go into sleep daily and you have to postpone the issue to next day. But sleep can never be understood because by the time you approach it, you sleep. In the same way, when you begin to approach this fourth state and question to yourself, where from my thoughts come? It is also a thought. The question, where from my thoughts come, is a wonderful thought. The thought progresses towards something, towards yourself, towards the source of its own origin. Just as the wave in the ocean recedes back into the ocean. See how the wave bursts out on the shore of the sea and again the wave recedes back into the ocean. And finally what happens? The wave goes and goes into the ocean until there is no wave and there is only ocean. Similarly, your question goes and goes back into yourself, and then the question disappears in yourself. Yourself will exist, and the question ceases to exist. So, the fourth state is a state where your word recedes back, where your thought retraces itself until finally it is nowhere. and you are there. This process should be daily practiced to know the source of your word and thought. Then you will understand the source of your word is yourself. You can call it I am. And the thought recedes more and more into the background which you know I am. And then there is no thought. There is only I am. From that I am, the thought has started and took the third stage, and then it took the second stage, and then it took the first stage. This is how we approached. We approached from the non-objective stage to the unknown subjective stage, because only we have to understand. Now let us also understand that we understood it in a reverse order. We have to understand it in the converse order. This is the first stage. This is the second stage. This is the third stage. And this is the fourth stage. Unless there are these four stages of utterance, you cannot utter any word or any sentence. The first stage is the utterer himself, who calls I am. The second stage is the thought separated from the utterer. The third stage is the thought translated into his mental language. The fourth stage is the whole thing uttered forth through the vocal cords, and then it came out into objectivity. Your sentence has become different from yourself. Your sentence has become objective of yourself. Now we are all existing in this stage. That is what is called the objective consciousness. The whole world exists in objectivity. One exists different from the other. Whereas in the bottom, there is the one who is existing, from whom all this creation is uttered forth. So, exactly the whole creation takes its own course. The same process which takes place in you when you are uttering a sentence or a word takes place on a larger scale with the creator and the creation. So the whole creation is uttered forth in the form of a sentence or a word in four stages. That is why the scriptures describe the creator as four-faced. If you go into any ancient Indian scripture, the creator is described as having four heads and four faces. In Sanskrit, he is called Brahma. These are the four faces. Actually, the fellow is not having four heads on his neck. It is the four stages of the utterance of the whole creation. So, what is the word exactly? Its meaning is I am. That's the reason why every one of us feel I am in ourselves. Everyone feels, I am coming and I am going. I am eating. I am drinking. This feeling of I am by everyone is the existence of the same word in every one of us. So it is the common existence in every one of us. Whereas in our head, each is different. In our heart and lungs, the I am is the same in everyone. Since our mind is existing in the head, every one of us is living different from the other, because we are in objectivity. When we practice approaching to the heart and lungs, that is, when we know the process of taking the mind to the heart, then we travel from objectivity to subjectivity, and then we travel to the one existence. Then we will understand that only one fellow is existing with so many bodies, heads and hands and feet. But when we are looking at the creation from the head, that is, mind different from the heart, every one of us is different from all the others. Everyone has his own ideas different from others' ideas. Everyone has his own personality different from the personalities of others. His handwriting different from others. His signature different from others. His beliefs different from others. So, the mind is the center of objective consciousness, whereas the heart is the center of subjective consciousness. The process of traveling from the mind to the heart, that is, from objectivity to subjectivity, when it is systematically done, it is called spiritualism. It is called the science of man. It is this science that is given in every scripture of the world. That's why the scriptures of the world are more scientific than any science textbook till now. Because however much humanity has advanced into science and technology, we have not yet reached the stage of studying the science of man. There is no university till now on this earth which can teach us the science of man. There is no professor, university professor, who can teach us the science of man. There are textbooks written thousands of years ago, and that is what we call the scriptures, the world scriptures of every nation, wrongly understood as the books of religions. The world scriptures have nothing to do with religions. For example, the Holy Bible has nothing to do with Christianity. In fact, Christ himself has nothing to do with Christianity. And the Buddhistic scriptures have nothing to do with Buddhism. The Hindu scriptures have nothing to do with the Hinduism. Unfortunately, the people of religion are trying to own these scriptures only to make them unpious and unholy. Because religion teaches how we are different from others, and how others are sinners, and how we are God people. So, the scriptures are being insulted by religions. But in fact, religions are schools to give us discipline to understand the scriptures. The scriptures never belong to any religion. They are far much older in their age than the religions. So, the scriptures speak as of the Word, which is God. How the Word came as creation. How in the first stage, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That is, an idea came to the mind. Before it came to the mind, the idea was with the thinker. The thought was with the thinker. The creation was with the creator, and the thought was not there, the thinker was there. Just as before the birth of a wave, there is only the ocean and not the wave. That is the meaning of the word was God. Creator and creation was one. That was God as Father. Creation became different from the creator. That is the God as Son. So, these two stages can be understood in the first stage of utterance. So, the meaning of the word is I am, and we should know now how the word is uttered. We should understand the word includes our total life, and before we are able to utter it out, we should know how it should be uttered. What is its meaning? it is uttered as inhalation and exhalation. That is, in every respiration we are uttering the word, and in every respiration we are uttering the word. That's why the name of God is called the Word. Once a great seer asked God, "What is your name? Suppose I go to Egypt and they ask me, what is the name of your God? What should I say?" What is the answer given by God? What is the answer? "I am that I am." That is the name of God. When you go to Egypt, when the Pharaoh asks you what is the name of your God, tell him, "I am that I am." God never said, "My name is I am that I am." God said, "Tell him, I am that I am." What's the difference? If God had said, "My name is I am that I am," then Moses would have gone to Egypt and said, "He is that he is." So God was very careful. He never said, "My name is I am that I am." He said, "Tell him, I am that I am." That means everyone who wants to utter the name of God should meditate upon God in the form of the meaning of the word I am. That is his own I am, not his I am. The fellow who understands God in objectivity is only a fool, because his God is his idea of God. In the name of God, he is only enjoying his own ideas, his own foolish concepts of God. It is a poor, ugly, religious God, and he is not God above religion. How can my idea of God be God? I should grow above my idea, I should leave off my ideas, I should offer everything before I know God. If I have my own dirty ideas about God, my own peculiar theology and philosophy, with all this burden on the head, how can I reach God? I should be able to shave off my head from all these things. It is not enough if we shave the hair. Our ideas and concepts should be shaved. Then we reach God. So everyone should meditate upon his own I am. Then his I am will break up like the egg of a bird. And then just as the chicken comes out of the egg, the inner word comes out in the form of God realization, the real meaning of the word I am. That's why whenever the name of God is given, it is given only in the name of I am. Do you remember what Christ said? He said, "I am the way." If we say he is the way, there is no use. He has to go his own way and we have to go our own way. The I am in you is your way to him. Then he said, "I am life." What is life? It is respiration. Your respiration is your I am, but you are not breathing, but breathing is taking place in you. Someone is breathing in you for you to live and survive on this earth. So it is the respiration of God, the name of God. This is what is meant by the word I am. And this gives us again the God awakening. And therefore, man is once again resurrected into God by the word I am. When Buddha initiated his disciples into his light, he said, "I am the light." You meditate upon the I am in you. And Lord Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita 5000 years ago, "I am the Lord of all lords. There is no greater one than I am the myself in every one of you. Meditate upon me, the I am in you. Offer yourself to me, the I am in you. and then be aware of the omnipresence of the I am in every one of you. So this is called the word from which the creation came, and it is called the word of God. And the process of uttering this is, think of your respiration every day for some time, then your mind comes to your heart, and then gradually you will have your inhalation and exhalation. They give you two sounds, two syllables of the mystic word. You will hear the sound so while you are inhaling, and the sound hum exhaling. So your inhalation and exhalation will give you the two syllables as already being uttered in you long before you could realize them. So you have to meditate upon the two sounds while inhaling and exhaling, and then there comes a time when the real word will be experienced by you. The two consonants will drop off. S will drop off from so, and H will drop off from hum, and the respiration stops and the mind merges in yourself. That is what is called pranayama in its real sense. Pranayama is not stopping the breath, but the breath automatically is stopping until once again the mind comes out. When you make this practice, automatically the mind stops. The only thing you have to do is meditate upon the movements of your respiration, and as long as you are inhaling, you meditate upon the sound so. As long as you are exhaling, you meditate upon the sound hum. So hum is the mantra, and when you begin to meditate upon these two sounds, automatically the mind disappears into your respiration. As long as the mind disappears, the respiration stops. Then there is the word. The S and H disappear, and there is only one word existing in you. It is called Om, the meaning of which is the real I am, yourself. Remember, you are the true I am, whereas your mind and senses and body are not yourself. They are only your belongings. They come out from you, they come from you every time. They serve as your vehicles, and again they go into yourself. Whenever you want it, they come to you. In the same way, the whole creation comes from the I am, as the many living beings. These living beings exist in his own I am, and again return to the same I am. So this, in short, is the word which was with God, which was God, which came out to man, which we are uttering forth as our respiration and our voice. Thank you all. Even a plant does the same thing. Even a human being does the same thing. Animal does the same thing. Even a mineral atom does the same thing. Sure. The whole solar system does the same thing. Sure. It has a centripetal and a centrifugal activity, which follows the law of alternation, according to which the whole creation acts as an electromotor. Therefore, the activity of taking in and giving out, in whichever scale it occurs, it is a sign of the I am existing in the center. The plant takes in gases, it takes in water, minerals, and the directly the life from the sun's rays, and it gives out the same thing again. So everything has the utterance in it. There is no atom that is existing that has no utterance of the word of God. The language differs. In an animal, it is a mental language. In a human being, it also includes self-consciousness. In the plant, it is only a consciousness which can be called the biological consciousness, having no mental consciousness. In the mineral kingdom, it is only the nuclear consciousness which is responsible for the nuclear activity of the atom. It is only the language that changes. The utterance is always the same. It is called the word. Procreation is a part of the fourth stage of utterance. It is a reflection of the creation on the surface of mind and matter. It's not an independent entity. The other three stages are called creation, whereas it is called procreation, which is only a reflection on the grosser plane. It forms part of the fourth state of utterance or objectivity.